Hi, Mimi. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm very well.
It's been such a huge month for you. So before we
Yeah.
begin, I wanted to just first of all welcome you to Mimi Meets. I'm Movie Mad Mimi. I'm the cinema editor at Gallery X Earth. And so we're always mad about film, mad about shows. And we were absolutely in love with The Empire. I mean, we watched
Thank
it in the
you.
opening weekend and we just loved it. We couldn't get enough.
Thanks.
So how have you been taking it all in?
I've actually already moved on to working on my next. I
Oh, okay. Wow.
think that's
Busy
the best
woman.
way. Yeah, it's the best way because of course, the accolades and all of that, but it's always nice to when you have finished something, let it out there for the universe and people to watch and just move on as a creator.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's a nice way of looking at it, actually.
Yeah.
Because I know you must, your phone must have been buzzing. Everyone's probably texting you, messaging you about like the reception. And so before we talk more about The Empire, I'd actually just like to ask you a movie mad question, which I love to ask people. What's the first film that made you fall in love with cinema?
Oh, Guide.
Oh,
It could
wow.
either be Guide or Pyaasa, one of the two.
And do you think that kind of inspired you to become a director?
I didn't know till very late that it was what I wanted to do, but those films left a very strong impression on me. The world of cinema left a very, very strong impression. And then actually, I saw my mentor's film, Devdas, in a theater.
Of course,
When I
yeah.
saw Devdas is when I decided that this is my world. This is the kind of stories I want to tell. And then I went to the Film Institute in Pune. And there, of course, I got exposed to a lot of other kind of cinema, world cinema, German, Fellini, Tarkovsky, and all those guys. And then I realized, okay, yes, this is what I want to do.
And you mentioned, I mean, the great Sanjali Lovansali. So a couple of years ago, I actually had one of the best experiences in the cinema watching Padmaavat. And so I wanted to ask you, what was it like just working with such a mastermind?
It's a film school every day. Some days he does something and you learn and you're like, okay, fine, this is what I'll take back with me, and okay, this is how I can do things. Some days you are just so awestruck by his brilliance and how his mind works. So, you are a student, you are an audience, you're everything in one. It's been a beautiful journey. I worked with him on Bajirao, then Padmaavat. And then I was also working on Gangubai when the Empire came my way, so I didn't finish working on that. So yeah, but it's always been like a great, great learning experience working with him. Because this was also my world. I found someone who was doing the things which I wanted to do. So that was an added advantage. Like because everybody can have different schools of thoughts. Every director has a different way of working, and I'd worked with many directors before Sanjay Sir. With him, I found the world I wanted to
You
belong
wanted to
to. So
create.
that's why and I was like, okay, this is the best training ground for me because I want to make these kind of films. I think larger than life. I feel, who am I to call myself an artist? But I've always lived in my own dreamland. I've always liked to create things which are a little larger than life. As a kid, I would love reading Jane Austen and going into that world, so I've been reading all those kind of things since a very, very young child, a lot of mythological things and all. So that world kind of pulls me towards it. So I think it's maybe somewhere the universe conspired to make me assist Sanjay Sir. So yeah.
It was destiny, I
It
think.
was, it was. I think I was meant to be there.
I know, and of course, when I first heard about The Empire and that you were involved with it, I knew it was going to be something special. And I mean, like you have so much time to kind of go through the entire Mughal era timeline because it's so vast. And I just love the
Yeah.
fact that we're gonna have so many like sort of different generations to see. Obviously, season two hasn't been made, but I mean, there's so much space, I mean, for that world to
I
be.
mean, I think it's a story that needs to be told. We have such a rich history, and not just the Mughal history.
Course,
India itself has such a rich history. There's so many stories just lying there that need to be told, which are visually grand. There's so many relationships and so much drama going on. I just hope more and more people make it.
I know, and I was so absolutely in love with that world, because I mean we've heard about the stories, but I mean I think you definitely brought something new, because like for example the Mughal women, like you've actually highlighted the Mughal women in this story, because usually we know about the kings, not the king makers. And so I just love the fact that like with Shaban Azmi's Ehsan Daulat is like the kingmaker essentially for Babur, and then Khanzada eventually becomes that for Humayun, and I was absolutely in love with that.
I think that was a very conscious decision that we took, because of course the credit for that also goes to Nikhil. Mm-hmm. Together we decided that how do we retell a story that everyone knows? We've read about Mughals in history and everyone talks about the warriors that they were, and not just them, any king. No one ever spoke about how powerful these women were. There are a few books that have been written on it, but nobody really knows. I mean, there's a Babur Nama, there's a Humayun Nama, and it talks about their lives. Humayun Nama, I think, actually talks about the women in his life. Mm-hmm. And Babur also somewhere does write. So we were like, how do we make it different? How do we make our story different?
Yeah.
Everyone has seen a warrior story. What is it that is new that we are offering? So I think that was one reason why Nikhil wanted to get a female director on board, to get that perspective.
Like the female gaze.
Yes. And being a woman, I mean, I wouldn't say, I mean, I'm sure there are many men who write very strong female characters, but being a woman, when I start writing, you put a little bit of yourself in your characters. Mm-hmm. And you tend to then write strong female characters. Yeah. You give them an arc. You give them more reason.
Yeah.
And you see them with a very different lens. You know, that there's this old saying that behind every successful man, there's a woman.
We should show it.
Yeah, and women are far more stronger mentally, is what I feel. Physically, we might not be, because we're not made, anatomically, we're not made like that. But I think emotionally and mentally, women are far stronger.
Correct.
So why not show that? Why not celebrate that? So that's what we tried to do here.
And I think you did successfully, because I mean, with Shabana Azmi, like, I'm in love with her Urdu. I mean, I'm always like, I love her Urdu and her, the way she speaks, the way she verbalizes everything. And then, but I think the surprise for me was Drashti Dami. I mean, I was absolutely in awe. I mean, I've known her for years. I've been watching her on television for years, but this is so refreshing to see her in this new light. One of the reasons was because of, I think because of you, because you've kind of shown us a new Drashti Dami. She's very much involved. Like you said, she's very, like even Ehsan Daulat is very much involved.
Yeah.
And Khanza, that there's not just beautiful women. Moving on to like some of the like, characters. I mean, let's begin with Kunal Kapoor's Babur. I mean, I thought he was so Shakespearean, but at the same time quite conversational, because it's the way he like verbalizes his lines is absolutely theatrical, but at the same time he's so real and relatable. He lets you into his soul, and that's what I love. And so, how did you like characterize Babur with Kunal?
So I was very clear, and this is something, you know, like when everybody would talk, you know, it's Babur, he was a warrior, and I was like, you know what, I'm telling a human story, and I had this conversation with Kunal also, like, you know, my body is sort of my physique and this, the fighting scenes, I said, Kunal, and you have actually caught it bang on when you say Shakespearean, because for me, he was Hamlet.
Yes.
He was always...
Definitely.
And if someone has been able to capture the human emotions beautifully, it is Shakespeare.
Yes.
So, and that's what, he is brilliant at doing that and playing around with the emotions of a human being. So again, like I said, how do we treat a king differently? We have always seen them talk in the baritone. They throw instructions at people, even like in a very personal setup, they would just be talking like that. And we were like, you know, no, this is a human story. It's a story about relationships. For me, Babur, our Babur in the empire was a king second.
Yes.
He was a flawed human being first. Why can a king not have self-doubt?
Yeah.
Why do we always want to portray that if it's a king, he'll only be making decisions? Why can he not be wrong? show the vulnerable side of it. And with Kunal, it's so beautiful because his voice, his face has that softness.
Yeah.
He's a big built man, but his face is a very vulnerable face. So that was like half the battle won any which way. So it took Kunal and me some time to get on the same page, because I think when he came on, he had read the book, and the book also talks about Babar as a warrior and doing this and that. And we put this extra layer of a person who's always in doubt, you know, like, I think that's the beauty, the vulnerability of a character is what draws you towards him.
Exactly.
It makes him more human. It makes him more real. It comes out beautifully.
Absolutely. Like, and watching his performance throughout the season, I mean, there's so many ranges of his voice. Like, he can shout, but he can be really quiet at the same time. I heard him once say that there's different, like, he had different levels of how much he would shout. Like, someone would say, okay, number one, number four.
And he shouted so much in the war sequences. So he had different levels of grunts.
Yeah.
And in fact, I remember, like, he was dubbed and he was shouting, and I was like, no, make it more guttural, no, make it more this. So like, we numbered them.
I 100% agree with what you said with Barbara. I mean, that's what was so different, because you weren't just seeing a king, you were seeing a human, because a king is always a human before a king. And moving on to, like, actually personally my favorite segments Dino? Of the season. You guessed it. I mean, it's not just Dino, but I mean Drashti and Dino together. I mean, Khanzada and Shehbani Khan. I mean, what magnificence that Dino can portray on screen. And I mean, that's what I absolutely love, because it's so refreshing and unique. I would never have pictured Dino and Drashti as well, like, in this light. And I was absolutely, can I just say, I was absolutely in love with Shehbani Khan towards the end. But yeah, so how was it directing the atmosphere or the milieu of Khanzada and Shehbani Khan?
I mean, I love the whole show, but I was a little biased towards their love story. You just feel happy. So I used to be very happy shooting their scenes. Even Maham and Babar's story is, like, very, very beautiful. But this one was, because it had so many layers to it. That's a very simple love story. So it's pure. This one had so much going on, because she came to him as part of a condition.
Hmm.
And, you know, as women, we always crave for the bad boys.
There is something
that just attracts you. It's always a winner. So I knew that. I mean, I always knew that character is going to really, really strike a chord with the audiences.
Mm.
And everybody was like, you know, when I saw Dino had auditioned long before I had even got on the project. And somebody was showing me the options for Shehbani, and they showed me Dino's picture. And I was like, wait, Dino? And they're like, yeah, but you know, he's such a soft face, and you know, this is such a mad character. I said, exactly why I want him.
The madness.
Yeah, because the character is so mad and so evil,
mm-hmm.
it balances out with a nice, positive face. Because when the face is so nice, you don't expect those things from him. Mm. He can be very sweet in 1 second and you wouldn't know what he would do the next second.
Yeah.
He has a very, what's the word? Elegant. He has a very elegant face. You know, has a very nice, calming presence. So and hats off to him. You know, I really believe that every actor is very, very hungry, and when given the right opportunity and when shown the right amount of faith, they can really do wonders. And he has proved all his detractors wrong. By he's done a beautiful job, I think.
Yeah,
he's actually surpassed my expectations. I knew he would be good when I would see him delivering the scenes. I would be like, yeah, he's good. But some of his expressions are just mind-boggling. Especially his last 100%. Scene. Oh my God. The way he's expressed through his eyes, the slight smile. It's beautiful. So shooting Dino was actually a lot of fun. He's a very chilled out guy. And that's even... Like, he does all his hard work and all his preparation before coming on set. So when he walks on set, you think like, oh, he's just chilling around and all, but he knows everything. He knows exactly what he's going to do in which shot. He doesn't show his process, which is very nice about him, but he comes fully prepared. So it was a cakewalk working with him. I had a lot of fun working with him.
And he mentioned that the inspiration behind his character was that of a panther, which I found was really unique. And he said that was actually you both kind of worked on that together, the panther inspiration?
So the thing is, I have this very bad habit of, I don't know if it's good habit or with this, it turned out to be a good thing, but I have a thing that I always equate people with animals.
Mm-hmm.
Like I see a certain animal, like I would see a sparrow in someone, like a pigeon in someone. I'm sure we all have these quirks.
Yeah.
So, you know, people always remind me of animals. So when I was writing also, I kept thinking of a panther every time I thought of Shaibani, and more not because of the way he would look, but of the qualities of a panther, very agile, stealthy, quick. He could just, and the walk is so regal, you know, like all these lions, panthers, they walk so beautifully. I thought more of a panther because the jet black coat also adds a sense of mystery to a panther.
And the dark eyes as well. The
color. Yes, yes. And that's the color I was seeing for Shaibani, blacks and grays, because that was a character. And you wouldn't know whether it would just pass you by or whether it would attack you.
Yeah.
You know, it would patiently wait and wait and wait, and then you don't know suddenly where it jumps out of. So that's where that had come from. Like I had told Drashti, I'm a swan, is what I had told Drashti for Khanzada.
Yeah.
I see her as a swan.
Yeah.
So I would do that with all of them.
That's so cool, because I love that. I think that actually does kind of help within, like, kind of getting into character. And what I loved was, especially if I can talk about, like, I think the scenes for me that stood out was obviously with Khanzada reunites with Barbara in the snow. I mean, absolutely beautiful. And then towards the lead up towards the farewell scene, I like to call it, between Shaibani and Khanzada. Yeah. I mean, it's so beautiful. I think that's probably become the scene of the season. You know, the love story is doomed, but it's so beautiful, like watching it. And I'm just a hopeless romantic. And I think you've kind of captured that gray area of like, Shaibani's no saint. I mean, he's not the perfect human being, but towards the end, you do feel for him. And so that's what I thought was so, like, I was like kind of like battling with myself thinking, why am I feeling so sorry? I mean, but I genuinely felt so sorry for Shaibani Khan. And that's what you captured, I think, perfectly.
You know, my whole thing with that was I used to keep telling these people, you know, Shaibani is evil. You know, you can't love him. He's cutting fingers and this. And he's somebody who doesn't trust anyone.
Yeah.
And there's nobody who can defeat him. And in the end, the one person that he trusted, the one person that he opened himself to and he fell in love with, is the one that destroyed him.
I know.
So that was a very, very, you know, star-crossed lovers and, you know, that whole feel of an unfinished love story. So I love that. That's my favorite scene.
It's personally my favorite scene. And when I saw the end credits, that it wasn't even shot like in a cold climate. It was shot like in India. I was absolutely shocked. Like, wow, like, how did you do that? I mean, tell me more about the locations.
So this so particular real. Scene was shot in Vai. It's in Maharashtra. We shot this in February.
Yeah.
So it's a lake. Of course, it's a dam, actually. It's a dam. And I knew that I had actually shot on a similar area, not exactly that place, somewhere closer for Baji Rao. We shot the climax and I had really loved that location. Mm-hmm. So when we were, of course, supposed to shoot this scene in Uzbekistan in a place called Charvak.
Mm-hmm.
Charvak is a place which has these snow-covered mountains and a lake and, you know, like snow all around. But we could not go to Uzbekistan because of COVID. And then we were like, what do we do? What do we do? I said, listen, one second. We have a beautiful piece of land and we have this blue dam.
Mm-hmm.
In Maharashtra, so it's not really an outdoor either. And we also created the village that you see, the Babar's exile village.
Yeah.
So we basically got everything in that one location. So this was there. I knew of this location. We all went and we liked it. And of course, in terms of production, it was easier for us because we could create everything in one location.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of VFX in it. So, of course, the snow-clad mountains that you see behind are all VFX. Mm-hmm. They were put on later in plates. The snow on the ground, so it's very, very technical and very, very boring.
I know.
But we had a VFX supervisor with us. Yeah, it's very boring. So all we had to do was, wherever there was interaction between the actor and the ground, we put lots and lots of salt. So we had like some 400 bags, sacks full of salt. So we lay that in the area that we needed them to walk, where the horses are running, and everything else was created. And we shot it over 4 days.
Oh, wow.
Mornings and evenings, magic hours. So, of course, we couldn't have the sun come out completely. Otherwise, you can't make it look like winter even in post. So magic hour is pretty much between 5:30 to 7:30 in the morning, or 6 to 8 is when we used to shoot. And then in the evening from 5 to 6:30 again. So we broke down that scene over 4 sunrises and sunsets. But I was so clear. That was one scene which was so close to my... All the scenes are close to my heart, but that scene was so close to my heart. I knew exactly what I wanted. I had broken it down shot by shot. Mm-hmm. And then me, my DOP, my ADT, my action director, we all sat down. We're like, okay, this is what we have to do now. This is what we have to do now. So we went very, very methodically about it. That one scene, we were so clear. And I knew that this scene just cannot... We can't go wrong. There was no chance for us to shoot it again also, because it was an expensive scene to shoot over 4 days.
Mm-hmm.
So thankfully, it's come out beautifully. And then I added that extra, that red cloth was my...
That was like so beautiful. Absolutely magical.
The funny thing is, when I read this, when I wrote and we were reading the scene, this red cloth was not there. It was never there.
Oh, wow. Really? Oh.
Yeah. So I was like, you know, how do we elevate this scene? Of course, Shaibani is dying. He needs to come to know that, you know, she cheated him.
Mm.
So, of course, the idea was that she's going to remove the cloth and she will throw it on him or whatever. But I was like, how do we make it memorable? What do we do?
Mm.
And then there is this beautiful painting I had seen. I don't even remember where I saw. Somewhere in Europe, in some palace, I saw this beautiful painting hanging, and it stayed with me. It was this orange cloth flying somewhere. I don't even remember what it was. And I was like, let's recreate that painting.
Mm.
So that painting was my reference point, and I worked the entire scene after that around that.
Wow. And absolutely, you can see it on screen. It was an absolutely magical scene. My favorite scene as well. So, I mean, I've watched it a couple of times, that scene, and I just, it never gets old. I mean, that scene is so perfect in every way. And I just want to say congrats on that scene alone. It's so magical.
Thank you.
And I want to talk a bit more about, like, obviously, like, costume design and music. I mean, that plays such a big role in the Empire, and I think it captured the essence of the time, really. Yeah. Because, like, obviously, like, when my favorite song actually was, you know, the Shadi song, when Babur
married that song. Mohan,
and then and Shaibani and Khanzada getting married. I love the Nikah song, and I don't know why. I want that to play at my own wedding, and I just think it's a beautiful song, and it just kind of captured that time and the location that they're in.
Yes,
and so how involved do you like to get when it comes to, like, music or costume design?
Fully, like. Hmm. Of course, I cannot take credit for what has happened, the music or the costumes. I cannot. It is Sheetal who has done the costumes for all my main cast. Yeah. And the song was done by Shail works a lot. Yeah. Yeah, he works a lot with Sanjay sir also. That's how I know him. Mm-hmm. I would only tell them the flavor I want, and, you know, the look, the feel and all, the colors and all that I want. And Sheetal did his job. On the music front, I was very, very clear that, you know, we have to do something different. So Shail is like a master. He is so well-versed, and he has studied music. So he understands. And, you know, I just told him once that, you know, bring in Uzbeki. A lot of Uzbeki
flavor. Influence.
So he heard a lot of Uzbeki music. There was one rock band, Uzbeki rock band, which I found. They use a lot of their throat. They use a lot of guttural sounds and all. So the song actually starts with that.
Yeah.
And then the music that he used, the instruments that he used, were very different. So it just sounds different. It's not like something you would have ever heard before.
Mm. Absolutely stunning. I like the songs throughout, but, like, that song, this struck a chord in me, the Shadi song. Beautiful, absolutely stunning. Hopefully, if we do see a season 2, I mean, fingers crossed, I'm hoping definitely. I'm so intrigued to see, like, where Aditya Steele's Humayu is going to take us into season two, as obviously towards the end we see he will succeed. Yes. Barbara.
Yes.
So I was absolutely like so sad when it ended. I was like, please, just one more episode.
I know. I have a lot of ideas for season two. The biggest challenge for me, if season two happens, is how to make it different from season one. How to give the audiences something new. So I have a couple of things in my head. I want to treat it very, very differently.
Yeah. It'll be so refreshing from season one as well.
Yeah. Keeping the essence of the time intact, keeping the history intact, but treat it very differently. How to make it fresh, how to make it a little more, I don't know, organic in terms of, I have my own ideas. I know what I want to do. I've discussed it with Aditya also that I want to make you a little rock star. So let's see how we can do it.
Like, oh, that's what I loved about the fact that it was a show and a season. You can have different seasons to explore that timeline, because I was just thinking, I really looked at my facts and I was like, 331 years. Wow, what a vast timeline. And so like there's so much, each season could explore a new generation. Yeah. And that's so absolutely like, hopefully that would be the plan. I'm just, I mean, I'm looking forward to it. And I want to thank you like for bringing that cinema experience to our homes.
Because I'm so happy. I'm glad that people are liking it. That's all that matter.
I absolutely think your show was just the first for OTT, because you've kind of brought that magical world like that you would probably expect to see in a cinema, but you've brought it to our houses. And like, I mean, I treated it like I was watching a film in the cinema. I had all the phones up, lights were nice. Off, and everything was basically, nothing came between us, me and my family watched it together, but nothing came between anyone. Like everyone's just hooked on the screen.
You know, I am so happy you're saying that, because when I was making it, and you know, a lot of times I would be told that don't go into so much detailing. It's for TV, you know, it's for OTT. People watch it on their phones. But I never treated it like a show. For me, because my training is from film.
Yeah.
I see everything as a film. When I'm shooting, I don't imagine that people will be watching it on their laptops, on their TVs. I watch it on the big screen in my head.
At home, we have a little cinema screening room that we like to call it. And we actually have, funnily enough, I'll have to show you a picture. We have a huge Bajirao Mastani frame behind. I will definitely send you a picture. And
Please do.
And kind of watch it as you're in the cinema.
That's how it should be watched. That's how have to be enjoyed.
Exactly. That's how I've never watched a film on a phone or a laptop. I don't like watching films on planes, because of the fact the screen is so small. And I think I'm a bit too much, but I prefer like that big screen, or even like a TV screen. I would never want to like kind of watch it or minimize it to that level. I mean, I always think that's how films should be enjoyed, and shows.
Absolutely.
And so thank you so much. I mean, you've been absolutely wonderful. And I've absolutely had such a great time talking to you. And
same here. It's so nice to have someone who loved your work and is so excited about it.
I know. I'm still excited about it. And I think I could rewatch The Empire again and still not. And I mean, we watched it within like, I think 2 days, we watched everything.
Wow.
Hopefully if I'm in Bombay, you're ever in London, you're more than welcome when we can have like a face-to-face chat, hopefully.
Definitely. I'd love that.
Yeah, no, that'll be so cool. And so, thank you so much again. And
Thank you.
And I wish you all the best on your new project.
Thanks.
But thank you.
Thank you so much. Have a great day ahead.
You too. Bye. Take care.
Bye. Bye.